and make the case for a balanced China-India-Sri Lanka economic cooperation and integration, but emphasizing more in terms of how we're going to take advantage of this potential that was identified by my previous speakers from the panel. So get more into the nitty-gritty of how do we take advantage of our location and being in such close proximity to such a large market. So I want to use a case study, the Indo-Lanka Free Trade Agreement, which I had the privilege of being part of the negotiating team when I was chairman BOI. Economic integration with India was first mooted by the late Dr. Lal Jayawardhan, whom I admired very much. He was a director of WIDA, the well-known think tank, economic think tank. And when I first read his piece and his rationale for India-Sri Lanka economic integration, I was fascinated. Now, many countries sign free trade agreements, but many people have concerns when small countries such as Sri Lanka sign free trade agreements with big countries. Now, there are ways in which policymakers ensure that small economies are not hampered or its economy is not in any way gobbled up, so to speak, by the larger economies in the region. And that is done primarily through what we call special and differential treatment, such as negative lists. So even though there's a huge asymmetry between the Indian economy and the Sri Lankan economy in terms of size, many such safeguards were put in place under the Indo-Lanka Free Trade Agreement. And let's just jump into the results. What, 15 or 18 years later, what has happened? So that is shown in this next slide. Now, what is important for you to note is that prior to the agreement, when the agreement came into effect in the year 2000, Sri Lanka's exports to India were only $55 million. In just 5 years, this export level grew by 10 times to $550 million. And of that $550 million, 97% of that $550 million were tariff lines in which Sri Lanka had preferential access to India. Now let's look at the Indian situation. Many, in fact, there have been eminent professors of economics in the Colombo University even who have not understood this fact. Yes, India's exports to Sri Lanka have grown. But if you take the average over the last 15 years, only 20% of India's exports to Sri Lanka have been under preferential tariff items. If you just take the Sri Lanka's exports to India only and India's exports to Sri Lanka only under preferential tariff agreements in the year 2015, Sri Lanka had a trade surplus with India, though overall there's a trade deficit. So anyone who argues that this free trade agreement has been to the detriment of Sri Lanka, I'm sorry, they do not understand the facts. And there have been university professors, regrettably, with whom I've had to argue the fact that fundamentally the Indo-Lanka free trade agreement has been a positive. You just go and speak to companies like SIET, Piramal, and Damro, and ask them whether this agreement has been beneficial or not. So this is my point. Now, why should we convert this free trade agreement into a comprehensive economic partnership agreement? Many FTAs have diminishing returns over time because of supply capacity or some of these tariff line items. India, in fact, having more domestic manufacturing. So therefore, over time, these FTAs need to be modified into more comprehensive economic partnership agreements. And this is shown, this concept of diminishing returns over time is shown in this chart. If you look at 2001, 2002, around 97-98% of exports from Sri Lanka to India were preferential tariff line items. Now that percentage has dropped to around 65%. So our $500 million or $600 million of exports to India, only 65% of it are exported under the preferential tariff line items. Now, this is fundamentally the case for the ETCA or what was known as SEPA. And SEPA, the underlying rationale for the SEPA is to include services and investment liberalization within the context of a goods-related free trade agreement, thereby gradually widening the economic cooperation by further liberalizing services. In order to encourage and enable manufactured products to compete more efficiently. Now I'll provide further statistics as to why a free trade agreement should naturally over time migrate into a comprehensive economic partnership agreement, particularly with India. Now recent research has shown, and I thank the late Dr. Saman Kalega, my good friend who passed away recently, for sharing some of these research with me. Recent research has shown that about 30% of value addition in manufactured exports of developing countries comes from services. This is known as the servicification of exports in manufacturing. Firms are increasingly providing solutions to customers that combine goods and services. In fact, it's interesting to note that the share of services value added in manufacturing exports goes as much as 40% for textiles and apparel and food and beverage in various global value chains. So therefore, there is no question that empirical research supports the fact that service liberalization will improve the overall competitiveness of manufactured exports from Sri Lanka and various countries. There's a further rationale for free trade agreements to migrate into economic partnership agreements. Foreign direct investment, the FDI increases, the creation of global value chains. Now again, research shows that out of the 419 odd free trade agreements operating at present in the world, 133 have already been converted into comprehensive economic partnership agreements, and all of them have services liberalization as a component of these agreements. So let's look at a little bit more of empirical research on logistics, impact of logistics on the economy. So according to the World Bank, countries at the same level of per capita income with the best logistics performance experience added 1 percentage point to the gross domestic product of that particular country and 2 percentage points in trade. Now recent developments, this is yet another case for comprehensive economic agreements. Now recent developments in trade show that compared to the trade in final goods, where products are made in the same country, this is migrating to trading in tasks where certain countries specialize in particular segments of the value chain. So increasingly, trade is becoming unbundled. Now, this is again classically explained by this particular chart of how a Boeing 787 is built. A Boeing 787 is built in 21 different locations and 13 different countries, because each of these components are manufactured in a specialized area. Now, can you imagine when these far and wide, these manufacturing plants that are dispersed far and wide, when they have to be integrated, there's a considerable services element that gets added to it, particularly in logistics, transport, etc. So that is why I touch on the issue of servicification of exports. Now, if you look at global value chains between 1995 and 2009, trade flows within these so-called global value chains, like what I showed you earlier in terms of manufacturing the 787, GVCs have grown in China by sixfold, India by fivefold. And research also shows that 60% of global trade consists now of intermediate goods and services. So again, if you look at this chart, in the 1990s, 20% of exports had import content. So only 20%. This has now increased to 40%. Again, because of specialization and servicification. It is now forecast that in the year 2030, import content of exports manufactured will reach as much as 60%. That is the reality. And in order to plug into this global value chain, it is absolutely important that Sri Lanka must introduce trade facilitation measures, trade and investment policies that are open, transparent and predictable, and an efficient and competitive services in the logistics environment. So let me now get into the Chinese equation. I just touched on India. Sorry, I'll only be taking 5 more minutes if I'm taking a bit too long. So One Belt, One Road. Now, this is big money. Various institutions that are linked to the Chinese government are proposing to invest over $1 trillion, AIIB, There's what is called the Silk Road Fund, loans from state banks, sorry about the spelling mistakes, and China Development Bank together are proposing to invest over a trillion dollars in creating this Belt and Road Initiative. Now, if Sri Lanka is to take advantage of the Belt and Road Initiative, I made the case that we need to enter into more free trade agreements. If you look at our regional peers, we have only 5 free trade agreements compared to over 20 in Singapore. So we are at the lower end of the spectrum. Philippines, Indonesia, Vietnam, Thailand, India, Korea, and China, and Singapore have more free trade agreements than what Sri Lanka has. This is shown, the result of this is shown in the next statistic. Our trade as a percentage of GDP is going in the wrong direction. If we are to plug into global value chains, this should be going in the opposite direction. Trade as a percentage of GDP needs to be at least 120% to 130% of our GDP, but it has dropped from 80% to around 50%. This is shown in the statistics of exports as a percentage of GDP in Sri Lanka. It was 39%, export of goods and services was 39% of GDP in the year 2000. It's now down to 20%. At least in, yeah, sorry, this should be updated, but if you look at 2017 statistics, it's below 20%. So the reason for this can be explained through a very simple chart. I present this because a picture says a thousand words. If you look at Thailand, in Thailand, over a period of time from the 1960s, you could see that apparel exports actually grew and then declined, the blue line. But that was compensated by exports of electronics, which grew over a period of time, and exports of machinery. So the decline in apparel exports was complemented and bolstered by exports of electronics and machinery. Now, during the same period, what happened in Sri Lanka? Blue line is garments and textiles. There has been no growth in terms of market share of electronics and machinery over the last 40 years. And that is because if you look at the years from 2000 to 2015, in the export basket of China, 76 new products were introduced, valued at $331 billion of exports. Thailand, 70 new products. Vietnam, 48. Philippines, 11. And Sri Lanka, only 7. New products were introduced into its export basket, producing around $100 million of exports. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is not a performance that we can be proud of. Now, let's move on to the final section that I wanted to highlight. Sri Lanka, according to UNCTAD, is the 15th best connected port from a connectivity perspective, because of its natural location. However, if you go into the World Bank Logistics Performance Index, we are ranked 94th. And the trend has been down, going downwards from 2012 onwards. 15th best in the world in terms of physical location, but in actual performance, 94th in the world. Again, people might question the World Bank in terms of how they calculate these statistics, but nevertheless, what are the components of the Logistics Performance Index? Efficiency in customs, efficiency in infrastructure, ease of arranging and competitively priced shipments, logistics and quality competence, tracking and traceability, and timeliness. In many of these factors, Sri Lanka ranks worst compared to countries such as Singapore, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, India, Philippines, and Pakistan. So, one of the reasons, take the Port of Colombo. If you take the terminals operated by the Sri Lanka Ports Authority compared to the private sector terminals, SAGT and CICT, SLPA terminals are 30% less efficient than the private sector terminals. If you look at the second chart, Sri Lanka Colombo Port achieved a berth productivity of 85 moves per hour. Well below Jebel Ali, well below Busan, well below Shanghai. But if you measure our productivity in terms of only terminals operated by the private sector, we are only behind Jebel Ali. It jumps into second place. So what is the rationale that the Minister of Port wants to build the next terminal using public sector money, government money, when it has been demonstrated that our very hub status as a port has been enhanced by virtue of private investments being attracted to our port. So, in conclusion, what I would like to say is that Sri Lanka needs now a fundamental change in its development strategy, from a debt-financed development strategy to exports and private sector-led FTI. We have limited policy options for fiscal consolidation. Our debt to GDP is 85%, but some might argue, oh, but your debt to GDP was over 100% in the 1990s. But there's a fundamental difference. In the 1990s, concessional loans, which we get at 1% over a 40-year term, was 95% of our debt, concessional loans. Today, that is down to less than 50%, because as we become a middle-income country, we do not have access to concessional loans. So more than 50% of our debt portfolio are commercial debt. So therefore, I believe that it is time for economic leadership with conviction and purpose, with focus on micro-level planning and execution. I believe that our future is in services, including tourism, ports and shipping, aviation, value chain-based and value-added manufacturing, knowledge-based services, financial services, and agribusiness. I need to add here one other sector, the mineral sector. We have graphite, we are told we have natural gas, we have titanium, we have phosphate, all lying underground, including gems, not exploited. Now, sorry if I'm taking too long, but these are my final comments. There are a few aspects that I want to focus on if you are truly to become the economy is to integrate with China and India. One, we need to become an assertive nation that becomes relevant to India and China. We need to position Port City and the Hambantota Initiative as truly Sri Lankan projects. I want to touch on the issue of sovereignty. The Chinese investors in Hambantota or in Port City do not own 1 inch of land. These are leasehold lands. And I also want to point out the issue of the Chinese flag flying. I did visit, as chairman of the PPP agency for the first time, the Hambantota port about 4 weeks ago. There wasn't a single flag that was flying. And China Merchant Holdings' name was not anywhere in any board because it is a joint venture. Now, how did my good friend Rohan Pallavatta get to know about that a Chinese flag was flown? They're your friends, the media. I know this for a fact. When the Chinese took over Hambantota, all the flags were removed to polish the flagpoles. That's all that happened. So let us be realistic, and something that I'm fundamentally against is what I call misplaced patriotism. We are all patriots. So therefore, I believe that as patriots, we have to enhance our country's competitiveness. We need to look at the logistics performance index. Recently, the finance minister of India said, India next year must move from 75th in ease of doing business to 50, number 50. Where in Sri Lanka, we are at 110. Very important point. We need to be mature in our diplomacy and negotiation. The success of a free trade agreement or a comprehensive economic partnership agreement, and in fact, even a PPP, is contingent on good negotiation. If we as Sri Lankans negotiate poorly, then you have international press or media or whoever saying we have sold out the country to India or China. Number four, we need to have a strategy of demonstrating that the Belt and Road Initiative of China is actually relevant to India from a logistics perspective. Because I believe that the BRI would help Sri Lanka enhance its logistical services to Indian companies that locate either here or in India. Number five, Sri Lanka needs to be cognizant of the fact that only 5% of total trade of the countries of India, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Bhutan, and Nepal are intra-region. So 95% of South Asian countries do not trade among themselves. 95%. Only 5% are intra-regional trade. Now, can we not, as a nation, set ourselves a target that because of our logistics advantage, by improving our logistics performance index, that we will play a catalytical role in taking this intra-regional trade from only 5% to 40%, which is what ASEAN is about. The ASEAN countries, amongst themselves, trade 40%. So these are my overall thoughts about how and why, and how we actually take advantage of all the conceptual frameworks that were presented by the previous speakers. We have to be bold, we have to take firm decisions, and one final comment, which sometimes I hear again from university students. In Sri Lanka, less than 0.5% of our workforce was not born in Sri Lanka. Less than 0.5%. In Singapore, 44% of the workforce in Singapore were not born in Singapore. So it's just not about trading goods and services. We need to have rational exchange in human resources, because it is only through attracting talent, attracting entrepreneur, that we ourselves can enhance ourselves as managers and ourselves as entrepreneurs. I can tell you, I have become a better CEO because I competed for positions with foreign nationals.